Okay. Hello. Hello, everyone. Good evening and welcome to this special episode of EcoMaster Surgical Technique. And first, I would like to wish you all a very, very happy Holi, the festival of color. And we all hope like with this festival, we should all get rid of this pandemic of Corona. And with that wishes, I would like to start this session. And this session is basically, the title of the session is Phaco Troubles Made Easy. Like, we are going to show the videos of the difficult situation in phaco cataract surgery and how we managed it during the surgery itself. So we have very experienced and very senior faculty for the video presentation here, and I hope they are going to make this session very, very vibrant and interesting. And with this, I won't take much time. I request Dr. Arvind Maurya to introduce our panelist first.
My screen is visible?
Yeah, it's visible there.
So our first panelist and speaker is Dr. Rajendra Prasad, and he is an alumni of RPEC, AIIMS New Delhi. And presently he is a director and senior consultant at RPI Institute and Research Training Center, New Delhi. And he has been engaged in continuous research and innovation for all the ophthalmologists, having publication of original work in at various national and international platforms. And he is more known for his innovations, which are very useful for all the phaco surgeons, like the terminal chop technique, swimming needle microcapsulotome, terminator the West tool, and high dissect for posterior polar cataract, and T-soft for the softer cataract. And he has been awarded many awards, and the few of those are the National Innovator Award at the National Constitution IMA on August 4, 2018, Chennai. He is also an IARSI Gold Medal Awardee 2017, UPSOS Gold Medal Awardee 2017, and ACOIN Gold Medal Awardee 2015. Also, he has presented the best paper at the AIOC 2017, IARSI 2013, best video at IARSI again, and at AIOC 2019, and at ROSCON 2017. And as a speaker, he has presented numerous papers, video demonstration, instruction courses at ASCRS, ESCRS, APACRS, APAO, and AIOC and IRSA. Our next eminent moderator is Dr. Ashok Kumar Barwa. He is a senior professor and head of the department at R&T Medical College, Udaipur. He is the past secretary of Udaipur Ophthalmological Society. He's also an executive member of the Rajasthan Ophthalmic Society, and he has been awarded by Dr. Suraj Narayan Gold Medal Award in the year 2004. And he has 50 publications to his name, and he's also a very well-known MCI inspector. Our next moderator is Dr. Shishir Agarwal. He is a senior consultant and at Dr. T.P. Agarwal Eye Hospital, Meerut. And he has presented his numerous original work at the state, national, and at international level. And he has published his numerous scientific studies in various PubMed review journals. Our next moderator is none other than Dr. Sandhya Makhija. She is a consultant at Sant Parmanand Charitable Eye Hospital. And she is an examiner of various DNB programs. She is heading the Delhi chapter of the Women Ophthalmological Society, and she has numerous papers and publications to her name. Our next moderator is Dr. Bhupesh Singh. He is a senior consultant dealing with the cornea, cataract, and refractive surgeon at the Bharti Eye Hospital, New Delhi. And he has presented his original work at state, national, and at numerous international conferences. And he has published his scientific studies in various PubMed review journals. And now, Dr. Anurag Badani, he is a vitreoretinal surgery fellow from the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. And he is working as a consultant vitreoretinal surgery also taking care of uvea, ROP and cataract surgery at the RBI Institute and Research Center, New Delhi. He is also giving his services at the Madhukar Children's Hospital, New Delhi, and he has been awarded for Best Interesting Case Presentation at Delhi Ophthalmic Society Conference. And our next moderator is Dr. Vijita S. Vimulpuru, and she is Assistant Professor at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, B.B. Nagar, Telangana. She is a former faculty and ophthalmic plastic surgeon and ocular oncology services at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. And she has authored numerous publications and various PubMed review journal, and presented her original work at national and international level. And her interests are ophthalmic plastic and oncology. And it's great to have such faculty with me. Thank you.
Click to exit. Thank you, Dr. Arvind, for the beautiful introduction of our panelist. Now I'll take up the introduction of the speakers. So our first speaker is Dr. Malay Chaturvedi. He is a medical director of Akshi Eye Care Center, Azad Nagar, Kanpur. He has been ex-registrar, Sir Gangaram Hospital, international member of the AAO. He's also senior vice president of IMA Kanpur, and he has been an ex-secretary general of UP State Ophthalmological Society. Dr. Malay Chaturvedi is a very vibrant and very passionate surgeon, and I know him for the last many years. A lot of innovations he does, and very, very interesting work he has done a lot of. So we'll hear from here today. And he's going to speak on small pupil, big crime, the devil, and his talk is going to be for the 8 minutes. Our next speaker would be Dr. Harvansh Lal, and you all know Dr. Harvansh is one of the internationally known phaco surgeon, a very compassionate and high-spirited and energetic surgeon. You must have seen him in live surgeries and all, and he's the director of Delhi Eye Center, co-chairman of Department of Ophthalmology, Sir Gangaram Hospital. He's also the chairman of the Department of CME, Sir Gangaram Hospital. He has been chairman of the AIS Headquarters Committee. A lot of positions he has taken. Previously, he has been the member of scientific committee and joint secretary treasurer in AAOS. And in Delhi Ophthalmological Society also, he has been secretary and president. So he's going to talk on toric surprises. What next? Our third speaker would be Dr. Reshma Jhaveri. Dr. Reshma Jhaveri, you all know, she's a senior ophthalmic consultant, Shoresight Eye Care Center, Juhu, Mumbai. She specializes in cataract refractive surgeries, and she has completed almost 2,500 surgeries in cataract and refractive surgery. Dr. Reshma has participated in multiple conferences, both national and international. She shows special interest in glaucoma, having done her fellowship from Aurobindo Eye Hospital, Madurai. And Dr. Reshma is a very, again, very energetic and high-spirited surgeon. She very active in other extracurricular activities also. Recently, you must have seen her in a beauty contest also. She won one of the best beauty contests in Maharashtra. So welcome, Dr. Reshma, for this session. Our next speaker is none other than Dr. Jagdish Rana. Dr. Jagdish Rana is very well known for his innovations, and especially the most important innovation what he has done is double tooth phaco chopper. This was published in 2013. He is the proprietor and consultant eye surgeon at Parth Eye Hospital, Ahmedabad. He has been executive secretary of Ahmedabad Ophthalmological Society, vice president of All Gujarat Ophthalmological Society. He has presented numerous papers in international and national conferences. He has been awarded J.N. Rohatgi Memorial a coin guest oration award in 2018. Dr. Jagdish is going to talk on management of armored cataract. Welcome, Dr. Jagdish, for this session. And our next speaker is Dr. Arvind Moria, a very diligent and matchless surgeon. You have to see him, how hard he works in operation theater and in his department. I've seen him in for the last many years and have opportunity to see him operating in his institute when he was in Jodhpur. Now he is the additional professor of ophthalmology, AIIMS, BV Nagar, Hyderabad. He has a lot of awards and presentation, the first to receive AIIMS Senior Academic Achiever Award in 2021, Best Video in 2018, Best Faculty Award in 2016, Teachers in Ophthalmology Award in the first International Beach Film Festival in Goa in 2019. And he has published almost 50 international and national publications in his credit. He is also in the editorial board of a board member in the International Journal of Ophthalmology, Visual Sciences. And he's also the member of DOS, Delhi Ophthalmological Society Times. He has been reviewer of many journals and state investigator of some of the important these services which he has done. So Dr. Moria is going to talk on combined phacotrap with Ologen in a one-eyed patient. So our last but not the least, Dr. Tushar Grover, very brilliant and very bright surgeon, I think I'll call it. And he's the son of Dr. Grover, who has been my colleague, and he was my immediate senior resident when I was in RP Center as a resident. He taught me so many things, and he's one of the best teachers. And you can imagine like how he must be treating and teaching Tushar Grover. So Tushar is the director and consultant at present at Vision Eye Center, New Delhi. He is also associate consultant at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. So at this age, he has hundreds of publications, which I'm not able to read out, and hundreds of awards and all, numerous publications and research papers. So welcome, Dr. Tushar, and he's going to talk on resistant towards resistance. Welcome, Dr. Tushar, and all of you for this session. And with this, I will request Dr. Malay Chaturvedi to be ready with this presentation.
I hope I am visible.
Yeah, you're visible.
And I'm sharing my screen. Can you see my presentation?
Yes.
So at the outset, I thank Dr. Rajin Prasad for such a nice introduction. In fact, we have been watching each other for quite some time in the field of phacoemulsification. And there are other consultants, like I remember a few people here in Uttar Pradesh, we have been working with each other. And a few years back, when I started the journey into the world of small pupil, I came to know that there's so much of activity going on in the field of small pupil. So there is a very big spectrum of small pupil which we are likely to face in our practice. And this is one of the picture of that spectrum. However, the things may not be as good always. And the things can be worse, like this, maybe sometimes this, 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 maybe as bad as this, or even a colobomatous eye. And that is why I call this presentation as small pupil, big cry. So when I was investigating this problem of small pupil, how to handle this, few years back, I tended to evolve a strategy by which I would be addressing And the step care approach would be midriatics, use high viscosity OVDs, do mechanical dilatation, use pupil expanders, and then iris retractors, and then combination and modification. Surprisingly, as I evolved my strategy, I came to see a slide from Khyodrov Institute, which was also going hand in hand, and they have a similar presentation. So this shows that our line of thinking is correct, because two people thinking different in different part of the world, similarly, the path of thought process should be okay. So here also you see that they use first dilators, then use viscodilation, then sanicheolysis, then pupillary stretching, and then expanders. And I would use iris hook in our Indian perspective. And when last year I was presenting in the iris meeting, I thought that when I will be talking about iris hook, people would be laughing because it is a cataract refractive platform. And I was surprised that people were vehemently working for this. So while we are talking about pupil expanders, we have to understand that iris hooks are still very, 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 very pertinent to our context. So a pupillary expander should be flexible yet firm material, and there are devices which are quadrangular, circular, hexagonal. What I understood that more are the angles, more it should be difficult to insert. So the first step which was tried was you put inside the eye phenylephrine perketoprolac. 1% phenylephrine comes with the international brand of Omidria, also available in India. And what Osher told, it does not aid in dilatation, but actually it prevents meiosis. So pupil expanders is a very, very interesting world, because so much of innovation and so much of mind has gone in, and it is really worth exploring this field. So we have people have used metal hooks, plastic hooks, iris rings, and one you can think there's a whole world. It's like the world of Jurassic Park. Huh? So let's have a look on some of the innovations in the field of ophthalmology, which is the field of expanders. So this is a Mosher ring. This is a Malugin. And this is a Asya pupillar expander. They use two X-shaped devices from both the sides, and that's how they get a four quadrangular opening. This is the Perfect Pupil from Milvela. They come out with an injector. And this is the eye ring, which is a very interesting device. Again, comes with an injector. A Greeter ring, I tried in my patient and I found it quite frustrating because of its flexibility. And this is our Suvin's BHEX, which has made an international mark. And it was actually when I was working on Suvin's BHEX, I came across so many expanders, and I then understood that the world of small people is very big. Now the Clark ring here, I would like to show you here on the lower right part. The Clark ring is also one of the expanders. The challenges are that there are iridocapillary adhesions, there are irregularity in the anterior chamber, there's an underlying chronic inflammation, and that's the most important part. And therefore, many times we need a combination maneuver rather than a single maneuver. So I would like to now show you a video. But the crux is that in most of the time, persuasion pays. And actually managing small people is in the mind. And we have to actually relax and take it easy and intervene. Allow me to share a couple of minute video. So here is the video. So you do sinicheolysis, you do mechanical dilatation. practically, I have tried almost everything in this except for the expanders. And ultimately, somehow this iris hook has taken a central stage in my practice of handling this small pupil thing. You really don't have to stretch too much. Just you see, you create a window which is worth operating. So there's less denting. And mind it, you just opened the window. The pathology is still there at the back. So we are going to deal with odd capsulotomies, odd phaco maneuvers. And everything will be different here. You just have to remove it. So a few weeks later, what happened? The same patient, even after doing the surgery, came out with such a membrane that it could not be done anything. Just you had to go inside and cut. It's just like, it almost looked like working on an anterior segment ROP. Just go inside, try to cut out the membrane, try from the right side, try from the left side. So that was I was referring to, that you've finished a uncomplicated surgery in a small pupil does not finish a job, because the basic pathology is still persist. And a combo maneuver may be required with adequate follow. And this innovation I presented in my alumni meeting. Instead of four ports, you can actually get away by using three ports. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you.
It was really a pleasure to be part of this team.
Thank you, Dr. Maharaj. And thank you very much for the excellent presentation of small pupil surgery. And very nicely shown how we can use the iris hooks very simply, and one of the very simplest methods. Although you have a lot of pupil expanders, but iris hooks definitely is the central stage, and it works very well. Can I see the people? Okay. Right. And I would request Dr. Maurya to have some comment.
Very excellent presentation, sir. Sir, my question is, what are your indication of using these iris hooks? When do you go for the ASEA segment and when to go for BX?
See, actually, it's a very good question. That's what I said when I present when I was going for Amritsar RSI meeting. I thought when I was talking about Qualisoc, people would be laughing because everybody talks about expanders. I was surprised. There's so many takers of Qualisocs because our membranes, our pupil is different than Western pupil. Well, many times you see they're rigid and they're inflamed. And even when Suvin, I was talking to Suvin, he told that if you're not able to insert your expander, you first do mechanical dilatation. So my take is that there should be no hesitation in using RSO. If you feel like use it, you're not a retro doctor. That's my take.
Right. Right. Yeah, well said, Dr. Malai, because it's the Indian scenario, like the iris works, it's very simple, like cheaper also. Like you get a very cheaper and it's very simple to use, actually easy to use. And I think it works very well in Indian eyes. Dr. Rana, you want to make any comment here? Yeah?
I want to, can I ask something, Dr. Arpi?
Yeah.
So you've shown a very nice videos and very nice presentation. One thing I just want to ask you, have you noticed like sometimes when we use these expanders or iris hooks or something and after you remove them and then you see the pupil remains dilated. I mean, it caused a little bit of trauma to the sphincter or the iris. So do you notice something like this sometimes?
Yeah, so I think it's a very valid question. I also had in my mind that when we stretch this pupil, they will remain stretched. But surprisingly, they don't. The post-op outcomes are not as bad as we would expect. Pupils, they start looking much better post-operatively. And anyway, they had a contracting tendency, so they will continue to contract. And things look better than what you expect in most of the cases.
True. Thank you, Dr. Malai. And we'll go ahead with the now next presentation is from Dr. Harvansh Lal. And he's going to talk on I will surprise. What next? Now, Dr. Harvansh is a little busy somewhere. So he has sent me the video. I'm just going to play his video.
Hello friends, I'm Dr. Harbansh Lal, Director, Delhi Eye Center and Co-Chairman, Department of Ophthalmology, Sir Ganga Ram Hospital, New Delhi.
Dear friends, today I am going to talk about toric IOL refractive surprise after a cataract surgery. What next? What is toric IOL surprise? Presence of cylindrical refractive error of more than 0.5 diopter post-toric IOL implantation can be called as a toric IOL surprise. There are two types of toric IOL surprise. One, non-correctable by toric IOL realignment. Second, we can call correctable by toric IOL realignment. Non-correctable by toric IOL realignment are when there is a wrong IOL on the first place, high spherical equivalent error which cannot be corrected by realignment and irregular asymmetry. Option for these are laser correction, piggyback IOL or IOL exchange. Now I come to the main topic of today. Toric IOL surprise correctable by toric IOL realignment. For this, we need only three post-operative parameters. One is the total refractive error, which we can call A, keratometric asymmetries, which we can call B, correctable corneal asymmetries by IOL at a corneal plane can be called C. So when we reduce B from C, this is the type of astigmatism which cannot be corrected because there is a difference between the corneal astigmatism and the IOL which can correct. This will be the residual astigmatism even in case of the best aligned IOL. Now, if this is reduced from the total refractive surprise or error which is there in post-operative, that means A minus D, we will get a correctable refractive error. That means the error which can be corrected by the realignment of the IOL. Now we come to the second part. Once we have got a refractive error which can be corrected by the realignment, we need to find out how much is the misalignment of the axis. So this we can find out by the correctable refractive error divided by the total correctable asymptotes by the IUL multiplied by 30. This gives us misalignment in degrees. Now we need to calculate how much is the misalignment, and this will give us the idea whether to go for the realignment or not. Now let's see the residual correctable asymptotes. If it is one diopter and the total correctable asymptotes by the IUL was 3 diopter, then misalignment is degree is 1 divided by 3 multiplied by 30 is 10 degree. While on the other hand, if there is a residual correctable asymptotes was 1 diopter, the same as in the previous case, the total correctable asymptotes by IUL was 6 diopter, then misalignment in degree is 1 by 6 multiplied by 30 is 5 degree. And in third case, there is a residual correctable asymptotes of 1 diopter, but total correctable asymptotes by IUL was also 1 diopter, then misalignment in degree is actually 1 by 1 into 30 is 30 degree. So we correct the misalignment. In the first case, the realignment can be attempted. In second case, it will be not a good idea to go for a realignment. And the third case, not only you can try to correct the 1 diopter, even if your error is half diopter, you can still attempt a realignment. So realignment is done when there is a significant misalignment, and it can correct significant residual asymptotes. Now I'll give you example of one of my patients. This is 67 years old male, presented to us on 21st January 2021. Lens star keratometric error was 1.39 diopter at 92 degree. Pentacam at 3 millimeter zone, total refractive corneal asymptotes was 1.5 at 93.1 degree. Multifocal toric IUL was planned on 28th of January. Multifocal toric IUL of 16 diopter and 1.5 diopter cylindrical at the IUL plane was implanted. Postoperatively, we had a toric IUL surprise. Patient's uncorrected visual acuity was 618. Best corrected distance visual acuity was 6x, but he needed plus 1 diopter of spherical power with minus 1.5 diopter of cylindrical power at 30 degree. Now, the lens star reading was 1.56 asymptotes at 94 degree. Pentacam at 3 millimeter zone was 1.6 at 95 degree, while at a 4 millimeter, it was 1.1 at 81.4 degree. So taking the reading in between the 3 millimeter and 4 millimeter zone, we plan to realign the lens at 90 degree. Now watch the video. When we made a reference mark, and this reference mark we found was onto the temporal side instead of exactly at 6 o'clock position. So now we are marking the 90 degree or 6 o'clock position slightly onto the nasal side. I make 3 indentation by the sharp chopper. The advantage of this is that these marks remain for a very long time, and they can be painted with the marking pen, which gives a very clear-cut idea where these marks are. Secondly, you can analyze which of these marks are more correct. Usually, peripheral marks which are close are more accurate than the central marks. Now, the marking has been done. We will open the side port incision which was made earlier and create another side port incision. Don't have to open the main port incision for this. After making the 2 side port incision, we inject the Xylocard to anesthetize the eye and then inject the hyaluronic acid underneath the anterior capsular rim and separate the anterior capsule from the posterior capsule. And you can see that the viscoelastic is going behind the lens and separating the anterior and posterior capsule very easily. Now we'll go from the other side and inject some more viscoelastic and push the air onto the one side. Once this has been achieved, the chamber is well formed. We take a dumbbell dialer, go from a side port, go at optic-haptic junction and try to dial it. You can see that this gets dialed very easily because this is not even 2 weeks old IUL implantation. Still, we go with the rounded repositor and try to separate if there are any adhesion between the anterior and the posterior capsule on to the one side, then the procedure is repeated on the other side. Same is done. And now on rotating this IUL clockwise till we get the exact position of the IUL. Important point to keep in mind is that when we rotate one haptic, the other haptic does not automatically get rotated because of the very soft and easy bendable optic-haptic junction. So we need to position both the haptic and markings, and we need to rotate on both the sides. So we are positioning it And once it comes to the 90 degree or nearly 90 degree or required position, we will take the viscoelastic from the eye. So now we rotate the another push from the another optic active junction and bring it to the position where we want it to be there. We are removing the hyaluronic acid from the eye. This is very important to remove all the viscoelastic from the eye, particularly from behind the lens. Now we'll go underneath the lens and the viscoelastic which is present between the posterior capsule and the IOL. And this is where the hyaluronic acid has got an advantage, because being cohesive comes out very easily and can be completely removed from the eye as compared to the dispersive viscoelastic, which should not be used in these cases. And push the air in so that the lens compressed and in position, hydrate the wound and press it to seal. Thank you very much for watching. Please subscribe our channel.
Okay, so I think this was a beautiful video by Lal, and he has many videos of such teaching videos, and he's very nicely shown how to realign the out of aligned IOL. Dr. Malay, any comment?
I just wanted to share that when we are dealing with the IOL, misalignments are not very uncommon. Unfortunately, these things have been seldom discussed on our platforms. So I think it is very good that Dr. Harbanslal took up this topic. Realignment is required many a times, and this is not very uncommon. Actually, measurement from measurement alignment, all the steps, there are level of difficulties.
In one of the situation, the first situation, Arvind has told, if your misalignment is, say, within 15 degrees or 10 degrees, do we still need to go for the alignment, say, within 15 degrees of misalignment? Dr. Arvind, what do you say?
If the astigmatism is of, it's very high, then there is not needed. I think 10 degree doesn't make a lot of difference. But when the astigmatism is very, I think 1.5 or 1.25, then 15 degree might not. Then we need to correct that sort of thing. And also in very the stabilized zone, meter to 4 millimeter zone, the stereoponous case, having very large cylinders. So they also fares well with the toricals. And I prefer optic capture, doing optic capture in those cases. And good. There's so much of the astigmatism. So.
Yeah, so it's very important, like you need to look at the amount of the astigmatism, what the patient had before the surgery, and the amount of the astigmatism, what he's having now after the implantation, the duration of implantation, and the presence of any of the adhesions in the capsule. Like if it's a very low one, then the adhesions become sometimes very difficult to remove these adhesions, and you may damage the capsule, and in that situation, your IOL may further misalign. So I think these important factors has to be taken care of, and Dr. Harbans has given very nice formula to redo these cases, and I think we have learned a lot this video. So
actually, a very important point, you know, very important message. We should use a heavy viscoelastic, and it should be fully and properly removed. That is the key point to it, you know, to avoid any kind of misalignment in the postoperative period. Very important to remove all the viscoelastic nicely, even sometimes below the IOL from the corners of the fornix bag and everywhere. So it is very important, this step.
Yeah. So one of the technique what Dr. Harbans has shown, like for rotation of the IOL, like it's very important. Never try to pull out the haptics for the realignment. You just de-adhesion, inject a good visco, and try to rotate it. So many times what we do, like with the single hook rotation, sometimes difficult because of the lack of space. So we do a two hook rotation. So you position two hooks at both the haptics and then rotate it. And it becomes very simple. Then you are not stretching the zonules and not stretching the capsule. You're just trying to rotate. They rotate very easily instead of pulling haptic out. Just rotate, it becomes very difficult, very simple. Yeah. Especially in IL exchange also, if you want to take out the IL, you just rotate it first and then take out the haptics. So we'll go ahead with the next talk by Dr. Reshma Jhaveri, and she's going to talk on "And Now It Tumbles: IOL Insertion Complications." Dr. Reshma, it's all your name.
Hello, everybody, and thank you so much, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, for inviting me to this wonderful platform, and thank you for the lovely introduction. Yes, I take part in the beauty contest. It was Mrs. India World, and won the title of Mrs. Beyond Giving. So thank you for all the support from all my colleagues in the ophthalmology department. Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. So I have actually a very, it's a very basic talk, but I think it is of use at some time or the other. This is IOL insertion. Sometimes we deal with complications, and I'm going to be talking today about one of my patients who I went through this problem. She was a 62-year-old lady. She was operated for a right eye cataract and used a trifocal lens. Her pre-op refraction was plus 2.25. So basically, it's a hyperopic eye. It's a trifocal lens. So obviously, we are there is you know it's a we want to just go right all the way, and it was a dense cataract. But while insertion, everything goes fine, the leading haptic goes in well, and the optic is settling in. And just when it's almost about to go in, the lens slips inside. So I will come to the video of this patient. But before that, I'd like I just want to say some few things that before before this aspheric multifocal IOL, and we didn't have this pressure of a plano post-op refraction. Inverted lens after implantation was not such a big problem as far as the refraction was concerned, because the refraction was not much affected in other kind of lenses. But what the problem in the other lenses, the piece lens, if it had gone inverted, would be that definitely the eye would have been in trouble. These implants, which are multi-piece, they generally have angulation, and the optic haptic plane is not flat, which is with these newer ones, with the multifocal and the trifocals, they have a plane or a flat surface. The earlier ones and the multi-piece did not have. It is angled or bent. So hence, when they are placed upside down, the implant can roll forward out of the capsular bag and into the sulcus. And this inverted three-piece can induce pupillary block or unindented myopia. But the problems that are caused with the multifocals or the trifocals are when they are planted upside down. They can lead to post-op complications like glare, dysphotopsia, pupillary block sometimes, iris shaping, sometimes elevated pressure, and their multifocality effect does not exist anymore. So what is important is to time it. Generally, the improper orientation of premium IOL lens will cause problems, and it should be recognized and corrected at the time of the initial surgery. Usually this process of repositioning the lens is very important with a generous use of viscoelastic, and is relatively straightforward if it is picked up early and done at the time of at the time when it's getting inverted. But for whatever reason, in this case, that did not happen, and the management became a little more complex. So what is the mainstay treatment? If the lens is getting inverted, flipping is a procedure of choice. And that's what I would be showing in the video that's coming up. And in this, there should be a good anterior chamber depth. And if the maneuvering is done well, then nothing is affected. So here is a patient whose lens has been kept inverted, had gone inverted. What I prefer to do is remove both the haptics out and the entire lens out in the anterior chamber. Both have to be removed out carefully so that the optic should not bend, the iris should not tear while removing, and a slow and gentle maneuver of the entire lens out in the anterior chamber make this flipping procedure a little more easier. I remove the trailing haptic out from the chamber. This is because when it is inserted inside or when it is flipped inside, both the haptics would also eventually flip and it should not really tear open into the iris. So I would prefer to remove the trailing haptic out of the incision gently and slowly by means of MacPherson or any blunt instrument that can remove it. After we get it out of the anterior chamber, I think it's very, very important to use enough viscoelastic both in the anterior chamber as well as behind the lens so that the bag is well inflated. And you know, the danger of tearing open the bag or of injuring the endothelium is less. So I use a high viscosity visco, and it is, I put it from both the sides so that it is inflated. And once we know that we have enough space to flip, we can use two Sinsky hooks to create this, to flip the lens. Now, rotational force of this optic is done by introducing one of the hooks on the anterior surface, just left of the center of the optic, and the other is put below the optic. And now, as we see, the lens is flipped. These lenses act well, and I think they behave very well, and they do flip easily. Once we have flipped the lens, the leading haptic is gently introduced back inside the bag, and post that the trailing haptic is also introduced inside the bag. So the main thing is, how do you prevent the rotation of this IOL? So most of the problems causing IOL inversion are related to inadequate attention to details during the lens insertion. The use of injectable IOL system, particularly those that require elaborate rotational movements on the part of the surgeon in order to correctly place the IOL into the capsular bag, may result in an inverted IOL. Correct insertion of the IOL within the cartridge is no guarantee that it will be placed correctly inside the eye. And sometimes forceps insertion also can cause reverse placement. So I believe in these couple of rules, that first is the correct orientation of the IOL should be checked before folding it in all cases, particularly if the lens has been dropped during the transfer. So incorrect orientation is indicated by an S sign, and S means stop. So if we see the lens in the S format, we have to realize the lens is not been placed in the cartridge in the right direction. It has to be in the Z format. And so recognizing of this S must signal to the surgeon to stop and check. Secondly, during injection, the free end of the leading haptic has to be directed towards the surgeon's left, while the loop held in the horizontal position at all the time via a series of pronation movements. So what I believe I went wrong in that case was my wrist did not pronate while I was using the injector, which is a screw kind of injector. So when I use a push injector while introducing the lens with my other, I'm a right-handed, so with my left hand I definitely use dial or something so that the optic does not get inverted. But when I use the screw injector, it is very important to pronate the wrist and see to it that the lens does not turn the other way. Okay, so this we all know how this the injector works. And rule number three is that should the surgeon decide the correction of the reversal is appropriate, it should be done at that time as well. So coming to the end of my talk, I would say that after doing all this, incorrect positioning of the lens has been reported in about 1.3% of the cases, and in even the most experienced hands. And it is important to nullify the torque which is created inside the cartridge by the intraocular lens as the plunger's dip. This talk creates an increased propensity of inadvertent upside down implantation of the lens inside the anterior chamber. Thus, to remember to use the technique that nullifies the talk by rotation of the handle in, while inserting the lens. Thank you so much for your kind attention and happy Holi to all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Reshma, for the nice presentation and which you have shown how to reposition the lens and what are the reasons for when you get the flipping of the lens in the while injecting. It's a very, very important topic because most of us get this complication during and many times we tend to leave it in the same position, but you have very nicely described like why we should not leave it inside. You have to flip it into a correct position. Generally, what happens like when you're injecting, the one of the haptic would go into the capsular bag, but most of the time the second haptic is out. And if you think that it has gone other way around, don't just try to keep the second haptic, like the trailing haptic out, and you can just hold the trailing haptic with the forceps and you can flip it easily also during the surgery. But if it is, if the lens has already gone into the capsular bag, both the haptics are there. For that, you have shown a very nice technique. Thank you very much. Dr. Sandhya, you want to make any comment here?
Yeah, Dr. Reshma, that was a beautiful presentation, beautiful video. And first of all, I would like to congratulate you. We are really proud of your all achievements and wish you all the future. So you've said very valid points and very nicely you've described how to deal with such situations. Any relation, what type of lens mostly you would encounter such problems with?
No, I guess it is, right now it's with the injector system. Sometimes for me, I've faced it more with the screw injector because I'm used to having my other hand free to use a dialer so that it doesn't flip. But when I use a screw injector, which ideally it's better because you are, it's a control movement with a screw
injector. It's more control.
Yeah, it's control. So I would definitely prefer to use a screw. But if you've not, if you've not used our wrist to pronate it while we are opening up, it can lead to such events.
True.
I mean, especially I would say that in our northern parts of India, especially we are in Delhi. In winter, sometimes we, encounter, we come across deep situations more often. The lenses, the eyes, especially the hydrophobic ones, you know, they get little, because of cold weather, they get little hard. And, you know, sometimes they get stuck to the butterfly sometimes. You know, so injecting sometimes could be a little tricky. So we tell our residents, you know, your presentation is very good for those people who are like beginners and our residents. So that's what we keep telling our residents, you know, maybe we just put our IVL, the whole box in front of a heater or blower for a few minutes, not too close, but just in front of small heater or a blower for maybe a few minutes. And then normally, you know, we can overcome the situation.
Sure.
Dr. Arfi, you would like to say something about it?
Yeah, definitely, because you have very nicely pointed out, because this is what happens sometimes. Especially in winter, if you have a cold weather, the lens gets a little tighter actually. So when you are folding it, when you put it inside the folder and while coming out, you see like these haptics are still stuck or the lens is still folded. They take a little time to unfold. So, but in that situation, most of the time, like the flipping, if at all it happens, you can very easily re-flip it because the lens is still folded. So you know that it's gone in a position, so you can very easily unfold it and reposition it. Dr. Rana, yes?
I think what more important is, first, what she has to import, thing of the position of IOL in the card, that's what's important. But in my opinion, I have not seen a single case of flipping over such type of IOL in my practice. Stop operating more than 15,000 phaco surgeries, because whenever I inject the IUL with the injector, I constantly look or watch at the tip of the cartridge. So whenever that I inject the IUL, thing should get open in the bag in a proper position. See, if it gets in a reverse position, I rotate the cartridge before it is fully out. So by rotating the cartridge and a full injector, I put it in a third position. So other than injecting a full IOL and then flipping it over, just look at the leading optic. If it is opening in a reverse position, then you have to rotate the cartridge in the hand only, proper position. So I have not seen a single case of this flipping over IOL in my practice, in spite of operating 115 or 20,000 fibrosaries. And also, yeah.
Actually, the screw injection is very, very slow and like controlled one.
Yeah.
Flipping generally happens with the shooter, actually, what I feel. But Dr. Reshma said like it happened more with this screw. Yes, Dr. Shishir, you want to say something there?
Yeah. So when we, 2 points to remember, I think. Number one, when we load the lens, if the two parts are unequally folded, then when it opens up, it would open to one side actually. And maybe the left hand you have, so that as it unfolds, you can actually control the unfolding and maybe rotate your hand so that it opens in the correct way.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you. So the next talk is mine. So I'll be taking up my presentation now. Which one is opened up? Sorry. Yes. Okay. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Good evening, friends, and welcome to this webinar, all of you. And my presentation is going to be on a very difficult situation which we all come across in our phaco cataract surgery practice, that is Argentinian flag sign or the radial extension of the capsular tear. You all know that the Argentinian flag sign is one well-known complication during the phaco cataract surgery. And what happens, the moment you prick the anterior capsule with the needle or with the Rex's forceps, the tear which you create on the anterior capsule starts extending to the periphery in an uncontrolled and in spontaneous manner, because you don't have any control on that, because the moment you prick, the tear starts extending to the periphery and you get a complete radial extension of the capsular tear. Now this problem can lead us into a very serious complication, because many times what happens, this tear, when it's extending to the periphery, it wraps up around the equator and it extends into the posterior capsule. So you get a posterior capsular tear. So if you get into the posterior capsular tear, so these are the complications you may come across and the whole surgery may become very serious. So there are several techniques because of its seriousness have been described. We all have been practicing 26 gauge needle aspiration, the myorexis, and so many techniques are there. But what happens actually, it's not the 26 gauge needle aspiration or minirexis or other technique, but it's the initial prick, because all the cases, they don't get into the problem of the radial extension of the capsular tear or Argentinian flag sign. It's these special cases or specific cases where you have a optimum intralenticular pressure, which actually opens up with a single prick on the anterior capsule. And although we have so many techniques, but we have seen in our practice, like incidence of radial extension of the capsular tear still happens in almost 28.3% of the cases in an intermittent white cataract. But what is more important is, as I told you earlier, because almost 7 to 24% of the cases, the radial extension of the capsular tear goes into the posterior capsule and turns into the posterior capsular tear. So we have come out with a very simple and very effective and very safe technique that is called as a saving needle microcapsulotomy to avert in flag sign. Now, this is the paper which is being published in JCRS recently, and what this technique says, I'll show you in a video, and this is video has a voiceover, so you'll better understand because by this video.
Welcome to our Institute Center, New Delhi. In this film, we aim to demonstrate an efficient new technique, saving needle microcapsulotomy, to avert urgentigen plaque sign during capsular access in patients with intermittent pearly white mature cataracts. The authors have no financial interest in the subject matter of this film. Urgentigen plaque sign is a well-known complication during capsular access in intermittent white cataracts, which typically arises instantly after an initial prick with a sharp hypodermic needle on a stretched out 10 centimeter capsule. Till date, it was believed that the recent blood pressure along with forward thrust of the nucleus is solely responsible for propagation of the initial prick into a radial capsular tear. To counter this, several techniques, including the small needle aspiration technique, had been described to decompress the back, but peripheral extension of the capsular tear has still been very frequently seen instantly after picking the capsule with hypodermic needle, even before the aspiration of the liquid cortex is initiated. It means there had to be some other factors responsible, which assess the raised intralentric blood pressure to propagate the spreading of capsule after the initial prick. On extensive clinical evaluation, we came to know that in reality, it's not only the raised intralentric blood pressure or forward thrust of the nucleus which causes the extension of the tear. There is one more important factor which is mainly responsible for the extension of the tear is the configuration initial prick created on the anterior capsule. Sharp tip hypodermic needle or Rex's forceps while puncturing the anterior capsule always create a cut configuration with discontinuous open edges along the plane of the needle. Since these forms of cataracts have liquefied hyperhydrated swollen lenticular material with an increased intralenticular pressure, relatively makes the anterior capsule tense and stressed out. Tense and stressed out anterior capsule with an optimum intralenticular pressure triggers off a disruptive force along the open edges of the linear cut and help the cut to open up and propagate towards periphery along its margins and split into a complete capsular tear. The disruptive vector forces always act along the axis of the linear cut. That is why the tear always extends radially along the open margins of the cut, but never perpendicular to the linear cut. This confirms that it is the linear cut configuration with open edges which has the potential to spontaneously open up and extend to the periphery. Henceforth, we came up with the hypothesis that if we were able to manually create an opening in the anterior capsule, which had a round regular configuration, like a capsulotomy in true sense, instead of a linear cut, we may provide resistance against disruptive forces, thus preventing Argentinian plaque sign. Round hole microcapsulotomy, round continuous circular edge, without any discontinuity, do not tear away with the sudden outburst of intralenticular fluid and disruptive force generated by the high intralenticular pressure. Simultaneous evacuation of liquefied cortical material through the hole decompresses the capsular bag and allows for intralenticular pressure to equilibrate prior to the creation of the capsular axis. To prick the capsule, we developed and designed a novel instrument saving needle microcapsulotome with round pointed tip like a saving needle system. The tip is approximately 0.75 millimeter in length, 0.60 millimeter in diameter, and which is angled at 90 degrees to the distal shaft. Saving needle microcapsulotome, when punctured the anterior capsule, create a round hole opening with smooth margins, unlike linear cut produced by the sharp needle. In most of the cases, single microcapsulotomy is sufficient to decompress the bag, but in some cases, multiple microcapsulotomies are required to evacuate the multiple fluid pockets in the lens. To achieve successful microcapsulotomy, after routine incisions, The entire capsule is stained with 0.06% trypan blue dye to enhance the visibility. Ophthalmic viscosurgical device is injected to maintain the deep anterior chamber with appropriate pressure. Using the main or side port corneal incision, the saving needle microcapsulotome is inserted into the anterior chamber. Tip of the needle is placed vertically over the center of the anterior capsule. Under direct visualization, tip is then moved downwards to penetrate through the taut anterior capsule. Round pointed tip of the saving needle microcapsulotome creates a round opening with smooth margins at the center of the anterior capsule. Pressurized interlenticular fluid gushes out volcanic eruption through the hole, which decreases the interlenticular pressure and helps in decompression of the capsular bag. Complete evacuation of interlenticular fluid, including the posterior compartment fluid, is achieved by tapping and pressing the anterior capsule posteriorly with the help of an air cannula. Once the capsular bag decompression is complete, anterior chamber is reformed with the help of cohesive visco to pressurize and flatten the anterior capsule. An intended 5 to 5.5 mm of capsular rex is initiated after tearing the central hole using a rex's forceps and easily completed without the risk of peripheral extension of the capsular tear. To conclude, saving needle microcapsulotomy with circular round hole puncture of the anterior capsule along with pressure decompression is the simplest of techniques, which enables us to successfully prevent Argentinian flag sign with very little effort and much easier surgical maneuvers. Saving needle microcapsulotome, a simple yet highly effective novel tool, is an ideal device to open up the tense anterior capsule to adequately decompress the bag prior to the initiation of the capsular access. Thank you for being with Saving Needle Microcapsulotomy, new technique to prevent Argentinian flag sign and intermittent major white cataracts.
So the most important point in this technique is like it's very simple. That is the most important thing. Like you don't have to use any major device or something. Like you have to use the capsular access or laser or so many things, because it's just a simple needle you have to use. And now we have come out with you can have a just simple saving needle, which is available in the market, which we use for saving the clothes at home. The simple saving needle, you autoclave it and just turn the tip and make it as a hook. And with that, you can just puncture the anterior capsule. Now, puncturing the anterior capsule, it gives you a small circular hole. So that is the most important thing. Because if you are making a circular hole, it works like a microcapsular, any capsular axis. So this is microcapsular axis. You are making a hole. So similar concept we have been doing with the microcapsular or mini capsular axis. But in mini capsular axis, what happens? You have to puncture. The cases where there is optimum pressure, they will go before you start mini capsular axis. Your capsule will extend to the periphery. But with this technique, none of the case will extend to the periphery because you are making a simple small hole at the center, which acts as a mini capsular axis. And if it's your hole is circular and round and complete edges are complete, it will never extend to the periphery. What is the pressure in the intraocular pressure? And then with that hole, you can evacuate the fluid out of that hole. Sometimes you have to make 3-4 holes because many times these cataracts have a multiple fluid pockets. Just puncturing one may not work, and you have to see like you have to put 3-4 punctures so that the whole fluid comes out. And it's not important to evacuate the whole interlenticular. Even as 1 or 2 drops of fluid, if it comes out, your capsule decompresses for the capsular axis. Then you can very simply start the capsular axis and it works very well. And a lot of people have started using this. And Dr. Arvind is one of the co-author for this technique, and we together have worked a lot on this technique. Now it's recently published in the JCRS, and they found it a very, very effective technique. Thank you very much. Dr. Rana, you want to comment any point in capsular
access? That's a very good technique. Yes, a very good technique. I think I should try it, because quite often a time I also get it, because I operate quite frequently the hypermetabolic cataracts. Yeah. And I will try it, definitely. It's a very good technique, sir. Yeah. Congrats. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yes, that is really wonderful, Dr. Harpy. It's a wonderful technique. I must do for a beautiful video and full presentation. And this arginine calcine is definitely a very, very important concern in operating mature cataracts and white cataracts. And mostly, I mean, many a times we see they do extend. You moment you start your exercise, they just extend, and then you just can't do anything about it. But this technique is what you have really, really helpful.
Yeah. So most importantly, this works in each and every case. So that is the most important thing. It works very well.
And I think one important point you highlighted is sometimes you need to make multiple punctures, because sometimes there are multiple pockets of fluid. This I think is very important, and one must take a look.
Yeah. So these multiple punctures have to be made within 6 millimeter. You should not go beyond 6 millimeters. So generally I make within 5 millimeter multiple punctures, so that when you are doing the capsular, it goes beyond.
Do you anterior ACT, anterior segment OCT prior to such cases? I mean, to
So the cases we try to do anterior segment OCT to find out fluid pockets. And on this subject, you have raised very nice question. Dr. Dhami from Jalandhar, he has done a very good study on these intumescent white cataract, and presented a lot of paper also on this, and shown that these multiple fluid pockets in the anterior pocket and the posterior also behind the nucleus also he has shown. So you get multiple fluid pocket. You have a multiple fluid pocket, then it becomes very important to do the multiple punctures. And then one single puncture will not work. Like in this, the needle aspiration also, like if a multiple puncture, then needle aspiration will also not work. But with the needle aspiration, the problem is, this is those who have to extend, they will extend. Even before you start, because your aspiration will start after you puncture, no? Because the moment you puncture, the capsule will start extending. So it doesn't matter whether you have aspirated or not aspirated. So he has shown very nicely like multiple fluids can be there, and which you can detect before the surgery with the anterior segment OCT. But many times you can see with the slit lamp also, these fluid pockets, you can very well see the fluid pockets, and then you can accordingly plan the puncture, one single or multiple puncture.
Also, the OCT guided microscope fares very well in such kind of to know the fluid pockets, exact location.
Yeah, that's right.